a mountain road in South Wales, and John Weston Thomas, worker in wood and metal, drives home with another repair job to do. He's 46 years of age, and all his life he's been surrounded by wood and by the tools to fashion it. He's the third generation of a line of such men, serving a style of work that the guildsmen of the Middle Ages would have recognized. He was born in Cardiff, but he lives now 8 miles away in the village of Gwaelod y Garth.
What's wrong with this one then, Matt?
Oh, look at it. It wants re-stripping. And repolishing, you know.
And there's a bit off the top of the
collar
there.
Oh, that's nothing. But the paddle box is gone altogether, full of woodwork.
He's now self-employed, with a crowded order book for harps, both new and old. But if he wanted to, he could build you a house or a boat, a model for a museum, or a set of surgical instruments, repair an ancient flintlock pistol, or make you magnificent furniture.
Well, I suppose it was inevitable that I became a woodworker. My whole family were in this line of business, starting from grandfather. All my uncles and dad as well. There's a tale in the family that my grandfather, of course his father was a farmer. My grandfather was walking through the woods one day and saw an estate carpenter working on a gate. And there and then he decided that that's what he wanted to be, a carpenter. So at the age of 11, he went down to Cardiff Docks to serve his apprenticeship.
The docks at Cardiff were once a forest of masts and spars, the shipping that gave work to father and grandfather, and in turn shaped the style and talent of the son.
So all the family were ship repairers, ship joiners, so it was natural that I became one as well, and that's where I get my love of the sea, I think, from that side of the business. And I love to go down the docks, see what's new. It's always something different when you go down there. Even the smell of the seaweed and the mud at low tide is pleasant to my nostrils.
Perhaps a romantic view of mud and the sea and ships. But it's romance built on a practical foundation. To his eyes, the strength of a ship's hull lies in the rightness of its shape. So he has a regard for the work of other men, the builders and repairers of ships of all kinds. Almost anything that floats can have a shape and a line that demands a closer look. To build a ship was always in his mind. The National Museum of Wales, where he once worked as a craftsman, commissioned a model of a slate-carrying schooner. So, in his workshop, the keel, the ribs and beams were laid down as they are in a full-sized shipyard, and the hull slowly took shape. Slowly because, as he says, the job takes the time it takes. Now he's reached deck level.
This is a model of a sailing vessel called the M.A. James, built in Port Maddock, in 1900. In seaman's terms, it's a three-masted double topsail to gansel schooner. They built these ships in their dozens to carry Welsh slate all over the world. As you can see, the model is by no means complete. There's a lot of detail to do, the masts, the rigging, the copper bottom, the hull. But when it is finished, I hope it will look like the original vessel.
Off and on, he's been researching this for 3 years, a trail that led to Port Maddock itself, and to the last remains, the rotting hulk of the original on a Devon beach. But now she's to be fitted out, and her masts stepped for her voyage to that museum showcase.
It's not a very large vessel, as you can see, actually, only 98 feet long. And with a crew of 4 or 5 at the most. The captain and mate lived aft, in comparative comfort. But the crowd lived forward in this black hole of Calcutta. The youngest member of the crew would be the cook. His days would be spent in this little hut on deck. Outside the door would be the water breaker containing the fresh water for the cooking and drinking. The great pleasure to me in making this model is that it's to such a large scale. Actually, it's a tenth of the size of the vessel. And everything that works, of course, does work. Windlass and the pumps. I think even the little bell forward will give a little tinkle.
For 5 years during the last war, he went to sea and gained new skills as a ship's carpenter.
And I enjoyed that part of my life, 5 years at sea during the last war. People used to say to me sometimes, what does a ship's carpenter do? But you'd be amazed, really, at the vast variety of work. It wasn't only wood, it was metal work as well. And you had the run, the usual run of ship work, like anchoring. I was in charge of the fresh water tanks, sounding the tanks every day, hatches, and of course a considerable amount of all kinds of woodwork, from fine cabinet work in the cabins to the rough work down in the holds. And I enjoyed it and learnt a lot, because you know, when you're at sea, you can't go down to the ironmongers or the local builder's yard to get something, you've got to make it. Or if you can't make it, you've got to acquire it somewhere, like the wood, because there was never any wood supplied. We had to acquire that by various means. At night was the best time, with the ship alongside and a nice log of mahogany on the quay, and you'd form a little sortie, and just before you sailed was the best time to get this log aboard. And I've, of course, broadened my experience with timber in that way. I met all kinds of exotic woods all over the world. After the war, I decided to better myself, or so I hoped. So I took a course in handicraft teaching and managed to pass the City and Guilds examination first class and took a post in London. London because they paid more. So we moved up to London and I got a job there with this school in a, wasn't a particularly good school in a rather tough quarter. I got on fine with the kids. I used to teach them Welsh hymns. They got no idea of harmony in London. But it grieved me, you know, to see this beautiful timber come in at the beginning of term and at the end of term being shoveled out in misshapen, horrible scraps. And I wasn't keen on London. The pavements are so hard up there, you know. And the inspectors I didn't get on with. I never had, like, discipline. So one thing or another, I decided to return home. But to keep myself sane while I was in London, I'd made myself a bench, a little lathe, and where we were in these digs, I used to make in the evenings miniature tools and models. Well, this case of miniatures represent the tools used in the building trade, all the various trades. Most of them work. For example, the planes will produce tiny shavings. Now this brush is interesting. In the tool catalogue it said best grey bristle. So I immediately thought of my mother and started snipping portions from her hair. And in the end she looked like seen from the Russian steppes. When I finished them they were shown in the Model Engineer exhibition in London. And later they went to the Festival of Britain at Southbank, where a Mr. Collier, a tool manufacturer of Brixton, saw them and commissioned me to make this set. This represents a more or less complete set of joiner's tools of the period 1890. The scale, 3/16 to 1 inch, was a little larger than the previous set, which pleased me because it made it easier to put more detail into them. My task was made easier by the fact that we already possessed them all in full size. There were grandfather's, my uncle, my father's tools, and of course my own. Unfortunately, most of the full-size tools, the family tools, were lost in this disastrous fire which I suffered some time ago. Except grandfather's ripsaw, the blade survived, the handle was burnt, but I can easily make a new handle, and the brace, this wonderful ebony brass-bound brace. Now, I have the original here. This is grandfather's brace. As you can see, it's a beautiful thing, made in ebony, solidly browned in brass, and the end is a clip. And when these were made, you had 36 bits supplied with the brace. They would fit this tool and no other. Of course, for some of the tools, I had to make miniature tools to make them.
Skills such as this cannot be taught, but once a week he visits a local hospital. There, students of occupational therapy are shown the simple elements and pleasures of making things.
So down to the line. Take it out of the vise and put it on the bench hook. Now, you remember what I told you about starting the cut? Do it very lightly. Don't dig it in, don't push it. Just dig in and jam.
No school inspectors bother him here, and he's free to pass on something of his own delight in wood and things made in wood. In his walks with his son, he explores a relationship with a new generation. From time to time, he's thought of starting a small factory, a center for his kind of work. But this would mean finding apprentice hand to join him. There's little hard cash in a dedication to a craft. And for today's impatient youth, no shortcut to skill and its reward. But at least young Allan, at 9 years of age, shares his father's enthusiasm for firearms. Shooting up a tin can before Sunday lunch steadies both hand and eye.
Now, see if you can hit that.
Good. What mum's got for dinner today?
I'm starving.
Pear Tree Cottage was just a ruined shell when he began the labour of rebuilding it to his own exacting taste. Now, carved stonework and seasoned timber house both family and workshop, and every space is filled with the work of his hands, and with those antiquities he loves and seeks to preserve.
I've got an example here of a Durin pistol, about 1820. The supreme example of a gunmaker's art. You see it has a gold-lined pan and a speed lock, flint lock, of course, Damascus barrel, beautiful piece of work. Now, about 17 years ago, I made a set of miniature Durin pistols, half-size. Complete with all their implements. Now, there's a powder flask for loading. There's a cut-off plate and a charger so that you can regulate the charge. A bullet mold for casting lead bullets. There's one in there, if I can pick it up. Little compartment containing linen patches which went round the lead bullet to make a gas tight fit. They were punched with a wad punch. This one started life as the half shaft of my old Austin 7, lovely bit of steel. Now the method of loading these was almost a religion, because in a duel it wouldn't do for one person to have an advantage over the other. So I'll try and explain how they were loaded. Now the first thing you did was to pour in the powder. Well, it was no good pouring it straight in like that, because the grains of the powder would stick to the barrel and you'd get a port explosion perhaps. So this is the cleaning rod, and this is the loading tube. It's screwed on. The charge was measured from the flask and poured into the tube. Pistol was then inverted like that, so there were no grains sticking to the barrel. The ramrod was withdrawn, a patch placed on the top of the muzzle, greased through the tongue with saliva, because if you were going to use a permanent charge you would use tallow, a ball placed on there, pushed in and then rammed home. I won't ram this one in because it's a terrible job to get them out. Then the pan would be primed. I'll show you with this one, as that's a little small. It would be put on half cock for safety. A little of the powder poured into the pan. Close the prism. Full cock. Aim and fire. And heaven help you.
If heaven for him includes the foibles of elderly firearms, it's also a heaven that's Welsh in sound and spirit.
Now te, gyda'n gilydd y pennych ola. Cord, Beatrice.
The Ysgol Gân, the singing school, meets every Sunday night after the chapel service, preparing lustily for the great singing meeting that happens every Easter. And it's his weekly pastime to help sustain that solid bass line.
I'm not a particularly religious man, but I've always said if there are no lathes or schooners in heaven, I'm not going. To be a craftsman, I suppose, you have to have patience, tolerance, and sometimes just to be plain obstinate. You know, to not to be deterred by failures, because it's all failures and disappointments which you, to do anything at all to rise above this, you must conquer. Now this is a model of a Martini Henry rifle, British Army gun used in the Zulu War. Now I have to make a folding back sight. Here is a full-size example of the real thing. And here is the piece I'm working on. Now, I'm often asked, how do I make such tiny things with these great ugly hands? How do I hold them? Well, the secret, of course, is to leave a nice long piece at the end.
With those hands, he's created a whole world of collector's pieces in miniature. Some of his best work is housed in a remarkable private collection at Pitt House in Berkshire. Here is his 19th century workshop, complete in every detail, even to the tiny mug of tea on the workbench.
Thank you.
an Adam music room for which he made some of the instruments. So he prepared the jigs, modified a lathe, and began a new project in an essentially Welsh tradition.
Of course, most of my work at the present time is to do with harps, the making of small Celtic harps and the repairing of old ones. New soundboards, new pedal boxes, mechanism, and regilding. Now, for example, here's an old pedal box. The pedal box, of course, the pedals worked in these slots, and the series of rods up the column which actuated the mechanism at the head. Now, in the old days, when this harp was made, this was cut out of the solid, which made it rather brittle and weak. Actually, there's one been broken here and renewed. You could break it across the short grain. Well, as a craftsman, I'm not averse to using new methods and techniques. And here's an example of one. This is a new one I've made. And I've made the entire thing in laminated wood, all in one piece, cut these slots out, and each individual one is thus very strong indeed. Of course, the glue, to glue these laminations. Now, I use a modern glue, a resin glue, which is waterproof. You haven't got to worry about temperature. You haven't got to hurry with it like you had to with the old pot glues, the Scotch glue, which was thinned out with heat. Mind, it's got its uses still in veneering. There's nothing like the old Scotch glue for veneering, because you can soften it with a hot iron. In fact, I've actually removed old veneers, 100 years or more, that have been on furniture by the application of heat. These old veneers are very useful. But this is, I like this stuff. That's, it's good enough to eat almost, isn't it? Now, this is the sound box of one of my Celtic harps. It's built on the traditional shape, with flat sides or ribs, which give it actually a better sound than the modern harp, which is a curved surface. You see, the back is made from mahogany and the soundboard from strips glued together of sitgar spruce, which is a very strong, resinous sort of wood. The center bar is walnut, and it has nylon inserts where the strings come. This is very good for the strings, as it forms a soft sort of cushion and prevents the string fraying and breaking. Now, the reason I like this shape of a harp is because it's very similar to shipbuilding. I build them on a frame, and it's, you can see there, it's all built up and is like a ship, complete with stringers, and later I put ribs across to withstand the strain.
The pull of strings on a well-tuned harp may rise to half a ton or more, so there must be strength as well as harmony in all its parts.
Here I'm reaming out the holes, the top of the harp, which take the small strings, and I'm inserting a little nylon peg. So you can put the strings in from this side, because you see my fingers are so thick, I can't get them in the little sound hole at the top. Now I enjoy immensely, of course, making a harp, but also I enjoy seeing the people's faces, this expression of joy as they carry them away, because you see, to a Welshman, a harp is a very precious and personal thing. There was a law in ancient Wales which said you could seize for debt all a man's possessions, his house, his cattle, his land, even his wife, but not his harp. Now, a harp, making a harp, involves all the things I enjoy doing most. The woodwork, the polishing, a little bit of carving at the top, and a nice bit of metalwork there. And it's a nice thing to look at. It's quite an ornament in the home, and you get a very pleasant sound from it.
To see and hear the instrument he has made coming to musical life under the fingers of a distinguished harpist is perhaps the crown of craftsmanship. This triple harp, with its multitude of strings, is the first to be made in Wales for half a century, and as difficult to play as it was to make. But even this is not the limit of his art. For him, the next stage is clear. Someday, soon, he'll be turning the first of the 2,000 parts that go to the making of the modern concert harp.
Satisfied. Nothing is perfect. You think at the time, well, this is good, this is the masterpiece, but when you look at it again, perhaps later, you see a little flaw and you think, oh, I could do better than that.